has a hard on.
The perfect world of dreams. Primitive.
Fucking asshole! He's a tight ass! He's a sadist!
You're all going to die down here.
The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
Happy heresies, my beloved true seekers. With love and kindness, I welcome the divine in you to Aeon Byte, broadcast through the God Above God Dad Cam. This is the first and only weekly radio show dealing with your favorite but least known heretics, the Gnostics and their brethren in the esoterica. We don't take prisoners, but liberate them. After all, Aeon Byte is stamped with the unholy seal of approval by the countless and innocent dreamers, artists, freethinkers, and occultists trampled under the ugly horses of orthodoxy in their Mongol march to redefine history.
Big Brother can make anybody they want look dead or alive.
So much blood, so many tears, endless shattered hopes. But you are safe behind the friendly walls of tolerance and alternative, in that state of mind where East meets West, we call the virtual Alexandria. You are safe here under the watchful eyes of Simon Magus and Helen of Tyana. Come on here, dear boy, have a cigar. You're gonna go far. You're never gonna die. Jehovah beckons us outside the walls. But we'll refuse his Lewinsky cigar and fall instead into ecstasy, which comes from the Greek word for standing outside of yourself. And we'll then turn to the Joker and the thief and tell them there is a way out of here at this late hour.
There must be some kind of way out of here.
Welcome to that dream of you, that hope of glory, that lingering milky sigh of forgotten gods slowly enveloping your soul until you wear the clothing of an angel of light, become a rising Lucifer from the warm infested muck of reality, and penetrate the boundaries of charged possibility like a fire giant storming the halls of Valhalla. In other words, you are here to be more than you allow yourself to be. I am, and I am Abraxas. I am you, I am.
I am the devil.
And together we're writing our own gospels and living our own myth. We are the spiritual descendants of the wise Seth, and the inheritors of the mysteries of all the rising and dying godmen. And that's all I'll say about that. Since in my last two shows, I've given longer speeches than Mussolini on coke.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
In this eternal now, fragmented in the illusion of Saturday, November 21st, the year of our Demiurge 2009, we discuss the mystic myth of the divine feminine principle known as Lilith. And I'm being almost redundant, because all myth is mystic, and all mysticism is contained in the mythic imagination. And all myth is eternal, alive, and darkly dreamlike. That certainly applies to Lilith in all her costumes. She who is known as the Queen of Heaven, the Queen of Demons, the first vampire, the CEO of all succube, the infernal muse to so many artists, the devourer of babies, the Baba Yaga story to make sure children don't stray too far into the woods of potentiality, and the grantor of your darkest fantasies. Lilith is the theophany of all your nightmares that are just as important part of you becoming Christ-like as is receiving the tweetering from the Pleroma.
I don't want any baloney, magic tricks, or psychological mumbo-jumbo.
With us to discuss this primordial femme fatale is Kelley Hunter, author of Living Lilith, Four Dimensions of the Cosmic Feminine. Not only does Kelley understand Lilith in her myriad masquerades throughout history and creativity, some that will certainly surprise you, she certainly has lived Lilith by her life and life work. And you, my beloved truth seekers, have also lived and beheld Lilith through much of your own life, but just haven't realized it. But hopefully we can soon correct that oversight.
Get off my tits!
Kelley Hunter is a scholar, artist, and seasoned astrologer who truly grasps the more real than real reality, that is the unreality of myth. For more information on Kelley, please visit her website, heliastar.com. That is heliastar.com. And get spiritually lubricated for a sinful gallivant into the shadowlands of the suppressed female aspect in our interview.
And declaring you a heretic!
Most of you here, okay, all of you here are far brighter than the hosts of this program. So you're probably aware of the conventional genesis of the perennial Jezebel, even though her dawning is far older. Long before Protestant critical Bible scholarship, many wise rabbis figured out that the two creation narratives in Genesis just didn't jive, much like the two Star Wars trilogies.
Don't do that!
In chapter 1, man and women are created at the same time. In chapter 2, woman is given form after man. Through mystical insight, daring exegesis, and mythological license, they discovered that Adam had a first wife named Lilith, her name perhaps coming from the Hebrew Layla or night. Yes, Layla, you've got me on my knees. But a better etymology might originate from her pre-Hebraic origins, maybe Sumerian, Babylonian, or Canaanite cultures, with the Lili or Lilitu, the names of mischievous male or female spirits.
Your suffering will be legendary, even in hell.
Anywho, according to Talmudic tradition, Lilith was basically cast out of the Garden of Eden because, to put it in PG terms, she wouldn't bring Adam his beer or remote control, no matter how close he sat to the television.
I can't have sex anymore. I have a brain.
She wasn't 86 because, being as wise as a serpent, Lilith knew the secret name of Jehovah and used it against him. The Demiurge dispatched his archons to the divorcee's abode in the Red Sea with his compassionate decree that he would kill her future children unless she returned to history's first dice men. Lilith gave him the proverbial finger, claiming she was now the champion of destruction in the subprime loan corporation created by the patriarchal god image.
If I were creating a world, I wouldn't mess about with butterflies and daffodils. I would have started with lasers. 8 o'clock, day one.
The heavenly CEO blinked first, deciding that he would just send out a memo telling his slaves that from henceforth, they needed to wear an amulet etched with an angel's name to protect babies from crib death assaults or to help women having childbirth complications. The amulet-wearing custom was later adopted by Muslims who still practice it today, referring to Lilith as Karina, Tabaya, or simply as the Mother of Infants.
Mother is the name for God on the lips and hearts of all children.
In the actual canon, our anti-heroine is mentioned only once in Isaiah 34:14. The passage states, "Wildcats shall meet with hyenas, goat demons shall call to each other. There too Lilith shall repose and find a place to rest. There shall the owl nest and lay and hatch and brood in its shadow." In the Testament of Solomon, a Hellenistic Christian work based on ancient Jewish magic, Lilith is known as the female demon with 10,000 names and moves about the world at night.
She's a bitch!
One of her names is Gilo or Obisoth, which is also the mystical name for the blacker side of the angel Raphael.
Did you ever wonder what a creature like that must be like? Oh,
whole existence spent praising your god, but always with one wing dipped in blood, would you ever really want to see an angel?
Her legend as baby strangler, Megan Fox seductress, party animal of the night, and continual hellion bearer spread like a swine flu throughout medieval times in all the Abrahamic faiths. Too many to fully address here, because my drivel will kill more than babies. It made its way into the Kabbalah, where Lilith is known as Nahama, as is written in the Zohar. In other Kabbalistic traditions, the Delphic vixen is the wife of the Hell Lord Asmodeus, and even the wife of Samael, the Jewish equivalent of Satan, and also, not so coincidentally, another name for the Demiurge Gnostic scriptures. Lilith is also referred as the Anti-Shekinah, the Kelepot force who takes the side of those unclean Gentiles and can even cloud the thoughts of God himself.
I am the supreme being. I'm not entirely dim.
Another widespread legend is that Lilith was the queen of Sheba, her riddles to Solomon being the same seductive spells she placed on Adam, although in the case of her ex-hubby, it was used as an anti-Viagra. And folklore until recently equated the Queen of Sheba as a child snatcher and vile witch who stole the Ark of the Covenant before it was rescued by Indiana Jones.
And the museum? The museum gets the Ark when we're finished.
Oh, yes.
There are Jewish and Christian tales of Lilith battling either Elijah or the Archangel Michael. Popular English folklore places her as Satan's dame, while German versions call her Satan's grandmother. The church lady from Saturday night would be truly proud of our disobedient filly, I tell ya. Lilith has been connected to both the planet Saturn or Venus, as well as the bad omen star Margalia. Lilith has been referred to as the Arab godlike Maimon the Black, or Astriga, the angel Astaribo, and believed to be the source of the Jewish concept of the evil eye.
We are found the witch, may we burn, huh?
And she's usually depicted as a woman with long dark hair and wings, but is also associated with the owl, the serpent, the cat, and the goose. That's just scratching the misogynistic surface, my beloved truth seekers.
How do you write women so well?
I think of a man, and I take away reason and accountability.
Lilith has been busy, and Lilith needs a good Hollywood publicist because she's been more lambasted than Sinead O'Connor. But not really, because, as Kelley Hunter reveals, she actually symbolizes humanity's revolutionary nature, the spirit of counterculture and rebellion, the quintessence of liberation from literalist systems and misanthropic cultures. Lilith represents so much.
Oh, I know people laugh at these things today, but if they were honest, they'd admit that there are moments on dark and lonely nights when something stirs within us and reawakens ancient fears and beliefs.
And of course you might wonder where she might fall in the Gnostic worldview. Lilith isn't mentioned in any ancient Gnostic texts, but there are parallels to Sophia, believe it or not. The fact that Orthodoxy has waged a Corleone theological scorch earth war against the two aerial babes is the most obvious one. They just can't stand them. I mean, who wants wisdom or independence around when you're trying to rule the world? Not the kind of chicks you want to hit on at your first college party. And it began from the very beginning in the Garden of Eden, with their fighting Yahweh and his universal healthcare plans for creation, always with the upper hand, as the drama tells us. Both godly divas are associated with the serpent, that soul-liberating kundalini phenomenon.
Snakes. Why did it have to be snake?
And Lilith, in her benign aspect of Inana, is associated with the owl, another wisdom symbol. Both Lilith and Sophia have been tied to Helen of Troy. The Ashkenazi folklore and the Simonian cosmology, respectively. Both are often referred to as fallen women or even whores in their legendary, and they exude very erotic moments in their various passions of self-discovery and revolt. But their similarities reside in the trickster god archetype, which is always male except for Lilith and Sophia. Everyone has heard of the exploits of Loki, the Coyote, Eshu, Prometheus, Tezcatlipoca, Hermes, Lucifer, and other lightbringers. Even Jesus has often been dubbed a trickster god in several esoteric schools because of the manner he grifts so many spiritual and material agents of the multiverse. But let's look at the trickster god prototype and see where Sophia and Lilith fall into it.
Why don't you burn in hell?
First, a trickster god is disobedient. Both Lilith and Sophia suffered the same fate because of their refusal to go along with the status quo. Sophia in the Pleroma and Lilith in the Garden. The same can be said with the Egyptian Seth, Satan, Prometheus, or even Quetzalcoatl in certain Aztec mythologies. Second, a trickster god is curious. They want to know more than what any boundaries allow them to understand. They want to explore beyond the territories of the accepted, taste the forbidden fruits of risk and opportunity. Because of this, they are often independent creators with a devil-may-care attitude, like the Coyote, who created man without the consent of the great chief. In the same vein, Sophia creates Jehovah without the release signature of Barbalo and the Virgin Spirit, while Lilith conceives demigods at the chagrin of Yahweh. They embody the creative element of disorder within an ordered world.
If we live our lives the right way, then every single thing we do becomes a work of art.
Third, trickster gods are mediators. Just as Loki is a mediator between the giants and the Aesir, just as Hermes is a mediator between Greeks and Olympians, just as Jesus is a mediator between mortal and heaven, Lilith is a mediator between the natural and the supernatural, while Sophia is a mediator between the nomadic and the Aeons. Fourth, trickster gods often aid humanity. Like the Greek Prometheus and the Indian Raven, who brought us fire, which basically represents enlightenment or expanded consciousness, Sophia assists humanity against the Demiurge in several Gnostic exploits, and Lilith possesses positive qualities and is a source of untold inspiration. And we can go back to her alter ego of Inana or Shiva's counterpart for more of the archetype.
Maybe the human race deserves to be wiped out.
Fifth, a trickster god is usually youthful and inexperienced, or at least personifies those qualities with sensual dissatisfaction and a somewhat neurotic personality.
I choose my choice.
Sophia and Lilith begin their journeys with rash decisions, when the first was the friggin' wisdom of the ultimate god, and the other knew the secret name of the creator god. And both go in that adolescent adventure into self-knowledge and redemption, reviled at first by deity and mortal, then revered and finally saved, even if it's in our modern days. Six, the trickster god, beyond playing games with humanity that are often for their learning, outwits their respective supreme beings. In African lore, the monkey continually outwits the lion, the king of the jungle, with his nimble wit and figurative language. We can see the same instances with Sophia, Lilith, Prometheus, Loki, and other deities.
Sun God will have his vengeance.
What's he waiting for?
The right time to strike.
His priests are dead and his acolytes are captive. I think your god is afraid of me.
And beyond the trickster god motif, let's be real. Both are as misunderstood today as they were thousands of years ago. Like many Gnostics have warned, it is not wise to worship Sophia or even consider her a goddess. She is, after all, a fallen being like all of us, a two-edged katana because of her loaded gifts, and, as Gnostic testaments reveal, often gripped by mood swings and apocalyptic indecision.
Okay, we need to divide and conquer.
No, it is better to understand Sophia, embrace Sophia, and become the story of Sophia. After all, Sophia is far mightier than any omniscient, omnipotent, or omnipresent ruling god. And the same goes for Lilith and even Abraxas. Welcome them to your home at your own peril, my beloved true seekers. Hide the babies you have given birth from your egoic mind. Let yourself be seduced into a thousand moonshadow dreams, and prepare yourself to be whisked away into the eternal night of impossible secrets.
Fiery the angels fell. Deep thunder rolled around their shores, burning with the fires of Orc.
Now let us adjourn to our interview with Kelley Hunter, author of Living Lilith, Four Dimensions of the Cosmic Feminine, and live Lilith like she has done. Or go outside and have that Lewinsky cigar with the old man and his angelic union. The choice is always yours. But one way or another, you're gonna learn something if you're just not careful. This is the Aeon Byte interview, and with us today we have the pleasure of having Kelley Hunter to discuss the mythology and astrology of Lilith based on her book Living Lilith, Four Dimensions of the Cosmic Feminine. How are you today, Kelley?
I'm doing well, going with the flow as well as I can.
In your book, you say that you didn't decide to work with Lilith, but she decided to work with you. How did that exactly happen?
Well, archetypes do kind of walk into our lives, and I found Lilith coming to me from different directions. And one of them was George MacDonald's novelette called Lilith. That is the first fiction I remember reading about Lilith. It's all a little hazy when I try to think back what the sequence was, because it just was facets, almost like a fun house in a circus kind of thing. And Demetra George and Douglas Block's book on asteroid goddesses came out in 86, and there was a mention of the asteroid Lilith there. And not long after that, I was at a meeting of the American Society of Dowsers based in Vermont. And there was a book on Lilith, Interpreting Lilith, by Delphine Jay, who wrote about the dark moon. And I was intrigued, astrological Lilith. And not long after that, I think it was 87, this is all in a time frame that was pretty short. I was at a conference in Montreal where Marc Berrio, a French-Canadian astrologer, was speaking about the black moon Lilith. So this was all very intriguing, that there were Liliths that were astrological. I've been an astrologer for over 40 years and been interested in mythology at the same time. And I think the mythology informs the meaning, how we live the archetypes in ways that are continually refreshed from our experience. It's not just a static sort of thing. We keep the myths and archetypes alive by our continuing experience and reinterpretation, revisioning of them. And Lilith became increasingly fascinating because she has been visioned and revisioned so many times. There's so many different ways to view Lilith. She can be incredibly demonic. She can be rather angelic. She can be etheric. She can be, you know, in the dark vampire world. She's never mousy. She's more cat-like or owl-like. Those are her two main kind of totems, I guess we could say.
And what exactly is the connection between mythology and astrology?
I think of it as a form of myth. There are the signs, and they all have their mythology. So much of mythology, as the people who wrote Hamlet's Mill, which is a fabulous book that talks about mythology through the ages, and their basic premise is that most mythology comes from the sky and our view of the heavens and our engagement then with the heavenly gods and the stars, the immortal ones that live so much longer than a human being. And this astrology has really developed as an interpretational form in a mythic relationship between the cosmos and our own lives. We're part of it, and it plays through the various archetypes, the myths of the planets. I'm not quite sure just how that all developed, the story myths of the planetary gods that are, in some cases, specifically, I'm thinking of the story of Inanna, Queen of Heaven and Earth from Sumeria, one of the oldest myths we have in human literature. It was written about the planet Venus and how Venus moves through the sky. And there are likely other planetary myths also written about the planetary movements and cycles. Sig Lonegren, a fabulous sacred space archaeoastronomer living in Glastonbury, talks about the labyrinth as being a reflection of the movements of Mercury around the sun, for instance.
And isn't it true that the myth of Inanna is the first time we really encounter the Lilith archetype in history?
Yes, and that makes Lilith so fascinating that she appears in one of the first two myths we have. Inanna and Gilgamesh go way back from about 2500 BC. And are probably some of the first things written down from a long oral tradition. I don't think we can call it history. We need to call it mystery or something like that. So Lilith appears in the tree that Inanna has pulled out of a raging river and planted in her garden, the original Garden of Eden. And before the tree could grow to maturity, creatures appeared in the tree. The serpent appeared in the roots of the tree, a wild bird in its branches, and in the trunk, the dark maid Lilith took up her abode. So right there at the beginning of mythic literature, we have Lilith in the tree with the serpent and the bird. And these are her the things that keep showing up in her mythology and in living experience. I want to keep making that point. And that's one reason I titled my book Living Lilith, because, you know, it's not just some abstract thing. It's even astrology. You know, we sometimes try to interpret according to, you know, what the signs mean and fit ourselves into categories. But no, they aren't categories. They are living energy fields. And we can get informed more about Lilith through our experience, our own deep and very particular and specific experiences, than in any other way, anything we can read or any myth. And this is another important way that Lilith came to me. I was working with Dragon Dance Theater in Vermont. They did a four-part, meaning over the course of 4 years, we engaged a different aspect of the myth of Inanna to play out in fields on Halloween or in the summer, mostly at the cross-quarter days, as it turned out, not on purpose, just because that's how it happened. So I got to play several characters in the myth of Inanna, and I got to play Lilith. And that also informed me greatly. Lilith really took abode, and it was not only the experience of creating mythic drama with that character and costuming her and engaging dialogue with characters in the myth and fleshing that out, so to speak, but also what was going on in my own personal life at the time and in several years following, in which I performed a monologue taken from the dialogue from that play and performed it in different venues. And it was always quite an experience that taught me a lot. Lilith is not superficial engagement. Lilith really takes you pretty deep into many layers of your psychology and spirituality.
Yeah, and mythologically, don't you also write that the name Lilith etymologically comes from these Sumerian female ghosts seeking sexual satisfaction?
Yes, that is one of the places the name comes from. I'm not totally sure I've nailed it for sure, but Lil is a wind demon, a wind spirit. The Lilitu and the Lilake are these disembodied entities, and Lilith has a reputation as being a succubus, as, you know, being a female demon who comes in the night and sucks the vitality out of men to give birth to her demonic children. This follows down in so many ways. This may be part of what gives her the vampire reputation. And we see Lilith as a vampire in numerous renditions. And very lately, on Halloween night, I was in New York City attending a wonderful performance by Justin Bond, who is a cross-dressing diva. And he was talking about personal sexuality being often sort of manipulated by disembodied spirits. And that was such a Lilith comment. I almost gasped. It's fascinating how Lilith comes down to us, often along those same lines, in nightmares or those disturbing dreams that tend to come when we can't sleep, or even daydreams when we're in anxiety situations, and in all of the clouds of regret and jealousy and denial that often are a layer of human experience.
It seems to me, like we mentioned in our chat before the interview, Nietzsche wrote that there's two parts of the human essence, which is the Apollo part, you know, the order, rational part, and there's the Dionysian part, which is that charged, psychic, creative, almost chaotic energy that comes out of humans. It seems Lilith is basically a female counterpart of Dionysus.
Yes, yes, she's wild and crazy and takes you beyond your boundaries. And that's certainly, you know, what she does and what Dionysus does as well. I think of her also as being associated with Dakini, which is the cosmic feminine in Tibetan Buddhism. And one of the books that informed me most in my thinking about Lilith was Judith Simmer Brown's book called Dakini's Warm Breath. And she gives a very deep analysis and discussion of Dakini from discussions with many Rinpoches and lamas over the years and her own experience as a Buddhist practitioner. And she talks about different levels of Dakini, some being people in our lives that come along and just kind of blow our minds, and another layer being some of the inner imagery that guides our spiritual lives. And then the most secret Dakini being the one that takes us right to the edge of the void and leaves us there. And I think that, to some extent, one of the ways I think about a level of Lilith is that she is the soul's deep desire to embody here on Earth at this time. And that there is this desire to return to the light. You mentioned Sophia. There's a story about Sophia always yearning and reaching for the light, that at one time as she's reaching for the light of the eternal light, she is distracted by an equally bright light and finds herself inside the earth. And then this longing to return to universal source becomes a yearning through every creature living on the surface of the earth. And I love that. I think that is so true to that soul's desire that is so distracted by ego issues and personality stuff and making a living and all the mundane nonsense that we go through. And we are at a time now in a renaissance, a rebirthing time, it can only be the feminine that rebirths us. And Lilith is one of the most powerful energies of the feminine to bring us through this consciousness shift or portal that we're going through right now. And we must give up all judgment and ideas and concepts about what we think it's going to be. You know, we don't have as much imagination as the universe does, but Lilith is there to really open us up beyond our rationalizations and our, she's not an ego-soothing energy.
Kelley, it's very interesting because it seems this warning or this eternal story already happened through the Jewish milieu. After all, the first disobedience against the patriarchal God wasn't Adam and Eve, but it's actually Lilith, wasn't it?
Yes. Well, yes, in the Bible, yes. And in the Jewish esoteric tradition, which you know more about than me, no doubt, Lilith was considered the first wife of Adam, who left because he wanted to be in charge. And she said, why should that be? You know, are we not created equal?
Exactly.
And he said something along the lines of, well, I'm created from pure dust and you're created from dirty dust. You know, he ends up being the original macho man who deserves Eve, you know, his rib for a mate like a crutch. Lilith did not follow the rules. And that's another aspect of living Lilith, where we don't follow the rules. There's that part of us that is rebellious, that is not socialized, is not accepting gender role models, is not going to be the good girl.
And in the mythology, I mean, it does continue. Lilith is, what happens to Lilith? She is banished to where?
The Red Sea. Very sexy, very feminine. And she cavorts with demons and devils. And who just those demons and devils are, again, I am not as studied on that part of it as probably you are. But she does utter the ineffable name of God, which only she knows. And how does she know that name? How does she know the word? You know, that's an intriguing part of it for me. She returns to Eden as the woman-headed serpent who gives Eve the apple. And we see that sculpted on Notre Dame Cathedral and painted by Michelangelo on the Sistine Chapel. And that became a very popular image for a few centuries in there. Lilith has just had these moments where she's been incredibly popular. One of those really big moments was in the 1800s. And you discussed that on your website as a real blossoming of Gnostic thought, don't you?
Oh, yes, indeed. In those days, yes, there was a whole esoteric and occult revival that became part of almost the psyche of European man. I mean, it was part and parcel of the Enlightenment period.
Well, Lilith was really taking a big part then. She was as popular and known by, you know, the educated and esoterically interested people and artists of the time as ever she has been. Today, you know, even. So we see paintings by Dante Gabriel Rossetti, who also wrote poetry. The pre-Raphaelites were very interested in myth and the seductive feminine. And George Bernard Shaw wrote a play which cast Lilith as the first human in the Garden of Eden, who realized that she would have to learn to cast her skin as did the serpent. So she strove and strove and willed for as many moons as there are leaves on all the trees in the Garden of Eden, and she gave birth to two, Eve, one like herself, and Adam, because she said it's too much for one. This has to be done by two. So she becomes a primordial mother, the first one in the garden, even before Adam. And there are other esoteric novels and poetry. Keats calls her Lamia and writes about her in by that word. And all like the seductive mermaid, siren types, very Lilith, very Layla Lola, Lila Delilah, Lila, any of those names kind of evoke that Lilith sound.
Yes, and it's very interesting that Lilith became basically, in the medieval times, a story to scare babies. People wore amulets to scare her off, and it even translated, even Islam adopted this custom of wearing amulets to stave her away. But then she resurfaces with someone who also wrote a lot about Gnosticism, Goethe.
Yes, in Faust. Yes, yes, in Faust, Lilith appears in a scene, and Faust dances with her. Though he is warned away, saying, you know, Lilith is dangerous. You know, she can wrap her hair around you and you'll never get free. And it could have been that piece of literature that was so popular in its day that really broadcast Lilith out there into the collective consciousness again. We have paintings, a very popular one you'll see on the web all the time is John Collier's version of this naked woman with a serpent wrapped around her body. American Kenyon Cox did a similar painting of that. And we have other esoteric novels and plays. One was a play from, I think it was the very early 1900s by Isolde Kurz, who wrote about the children of Lilith. And she writes that God blamed Adam for the fall because he did not honor Lilith in her full glory. There's always a different interpretation of Lilith. As much as we get a negative one, we get a positive one. You know, there is so many different ways that tells us more about the dark mirror of our inner condition than, you know, than anything else really. And it's also colored different eras, I think, in our collective as well. This being another one, I've been like, I'm continually amazed at how many Lilith references there are on the web and in arts even today. It never really stopped.
No, like you mentioned, the very popular Lilith Fair has become a staple of American modern music.
Yes, and that is probably the first time so many people heard her name. But then we have, well, we have Peter Gabriel's song, Lily White Lilith. We have a 2008 alternate rock group called Lilith's Army. We have, just the other night, I was looking on the web and finding some very interesting YouTubes, several of them put up by this woman living in Brazil whose YouTube moniker is Undefined Lilith, and she has very evocative stuff up there. So it is fascinating the engagement of the collective consciousness with Lilith now. Now, at this time, which is a pretty potent time cosmically with the 2012 time lurking soon, in which we are going to have our winter solstice sunrise aligned with the center of the Milky Way galaxy, as most precisely as it gets in 26,000 years. This is truly a consciousness portal recognized by the Mayans and therefore mentioned in their calendars. But it is an amazing time of being align in such a rare way with the galactic center, the heart of the Milky Way galaxy. And, you know, scientists say there's a black hole there that eats the light, but I say Lilith is dancing with her lover in that black hole.
You even write that in the collective consciousness, Lilith even thrives in the East. Isn't she associated with the goddess Kali?
Yes, I think that name, you know, is close enough to count. And similarly to Lilith, Kali has that both very negative and very positive, you know, kind of beyond judgment, really, truly, reputation, and is both a creatrix, but also the destructor, the destroyer of whatever is no longer life-giving and vital. You know, she's something to contend with. Even her consort, Shiva, tried to run away at one point, and she surrounded him with 10 versions of herself. So there are, you know, all these many facets.
Yeah, she reminds me of kind of Jung's concept of the shadow, this darkness that permeates us, but is actually our unconscious telling us messages that we must heed.
Yes.
It just manifests itself in a sort of chaotic, sometimes seemingly evil way.
Yes, because it's an ego buster, and our ego is certainly going to say, I want to hold on. I don't want, you know, I don't want to be destroyed. I'm in charge here, and rather like Adam in the garden, you know, and the subconscious or the superconscious comes along with the apple and says, eat this. Yes, it's definitely a dance when Lilith comes along, and it's not, you know, something you necessarily ask for. She definitely invites. She kind of like crooks her little finger and says, come along.
What is the connection between Lilith and the myth of Medusa? What are the lessons there as well?
Well, there's a very interesting connection to the star, Algol, that marks Eye of Medusa in the constellation Perseus. Perseus is the guy that cut off the head of Medusa. So the constellation image is he's holding the magic sword in one hand, and in the other he's holding the head of Medusa, usually by her snaky hair. And that section of the constellation is this little curve of stars that used to be called Caput Medusa. And the brightest star, Algol, that's a binary eclipsing star, where the two stars eclipse each other every 2.5 days from our point of view, like the baleful eye of Medusa winking and blinking at us. So that star is the eye of Medusa. But somehow, oh, and it's been called Lilith by the Hebrews. But there must be another way to tune into that wavelength as well, because there's a Canadian artist, Lillian Broca, who did a 7-year exploration through art of Lilith. And in one of those images, she brings forth a Medusa with a serpent tail, rather like the way Lilith appears in the tree in the Garden of Eden to Eve and Adam. But there must be a deeper resonance for her to have found that link herself and bring Medusa in to her series, where she's depicting various facets of the relationships between Eve and Lilith and Adam.
Besides what you've mentioned, you bring up plenty of examples of Lilith in culture throughout history. The one I really liked is the play Lilith, in which Adam is having his funeral, and Lilith shows up and ruins everything.
Oh, that was in 2001, an opera put on by the New York City Opera. And it was only 3 performances, and it was a very modern reinterpretation of the myth of Adam, Eve, and Lilith. And yeah, Lilith shows up at the funeral, and Eve has to tell her children, who Lilith is. And that there is a prophecy that Lilith will never be whole without Eve, and Eve will never be whole without Lilith, so they try to merge, and they just can't quite get there.
Yeah, again, it's that Apollo and Dionysus who have to stand side by side, but can never really be one and the same.
Oh, yes, and, you know, how do we live them both out? How do we, you know, find a not necessarily a balance, but at least a dialogue or an engagement with both, because we can't live just one. It's like the left brain and the right brain.
And going into astrology, you already mentioned the star Algol, which I had to chuckle because you referenced him to Al Gore. I thought that was an interesting coincidence. But it is.
He has Al Gore very strong in his chart. Yes, well, that is one of the Liliths. And that was one of the fascinating aspects about the astrological research, is that they're all such different things. In the beginning of our discussion, I mentioned the asteroid Lilith, which I call the hard rock Lilith, because it's the only rocky, embodied, astronomical object called Lilith. And there it is. We can even land on it if we wanted to go there. And to me, it seems to be the one that is that rebelling against society's values and standards kind of one. Think that we all have that place inside us that just doesn't buy into some aspect of the standard. And some people have that more strongly defined in their lives than others. Some unusual people, like Alanis Morissette or Michael J. Fox, have the asteroid very, very strong. And the Dalai Lama as well. So the asteroid, as any of the Liliths, can manifest in different ways and be engaged in different themes or stances. And all of the Liliths, you know, there they are. It's like the same note at a different octave. And though they might be in different realms, so to speak, or even we can experience them differently in our lives, nevertheless, they all can interchange their themes and energies, I think, in some way. So then we have the dark moon that Delphine Jay wrote about so eloquently, and many American astrologers have written about the dark moon, which is a second satellite of the Earth. So besides our moon, which reflects the light of the sun and goes around the Earth, there is a rumored shadow moon that does not reflect the light of the sun, of consciousness, of day, but has its own shadowy realm. Whether it's there or not, modern astronomers don't see it. They say if any astronomer saw it a couple of centuries ago, it must have been a speck of dust on their telescope. But perhaps it's a ghost moon or an astral moon or a moon that used to be there but isn't anymore or is on that other level. And I do think of it as very astral, like the fairy kingdoms and the other worlds and the through-the-looking-glass area and, you know, kind of an astral dust cloud we all go through on our way here. We get stuck up with some stuff. And that's the vampire worlds one. That's the shadow, as you mentioned, that we need to redeem. We need to clear that up. We need to get that kind of, you know, cleansed in our system somehow.
Do all astrologers accept the dark moon, or is this still a debatable issue?
Oh, it's debatable. And none of the Liliths are used in standard practice. As I said, there's more written in English, more American work done on the dark moon. But the black moon, and sometimes the black moon is called the dark moon, and the dark moon is called the black moon, so it's not always easy to distinguish. But the black moon is not even a body remotely. The black moon is the second focus of the moon's orbit around the Earth. No orbit is a perfect circle with a single center. Orbits are elliptical and have two focus points. So the Earth is one, and this point called the black moon, Lilith, is the other. And it's a point, a mathematically relevant point, intimately connected to our Earth-Moon experience, which is why I think of it as the soul's deep desire that brings us here, which is not a life purpose or a reason for being or nothing so rational, but it's that call to embodiment. It was the fall of Lucifer. It was the fall of man, one could even say. You know, we fell down into this place, this dense physicality, and yet the black moon wants to redeem or wants to bring the light fully into incarnation. And therefore, you know, Lilith is not demonic. You know, we could call her angelic. You know, we could call her etheric, which is the fifth element that the Buddhists and Hindus and Greeks called the element underlying the four physical elements, earth, air, fire, and water.
Yeah, and it's called the Akasha as well.
Akasha, mm-hmm. Right. There's that great movie called The Fifth Element where Bruce Willis saves the world yet again. And the fifth element is this embodied feminine, you know, perfection of God, goddess, and is basically an incarnation of love and intelligence.
Yeah, her name is, Kelley, and her name is Lilu, of all things.
That's right. Yes. Yes, that's a variation. My sister named her dog Lilu.
Kelley, don't you also relate the black moon to the black Madonna? Could you expand a little bit on this?
Oh, I do. One reason is that the black moon is more used in Europe, where there are so many black Madonnas. And you have lots of literature about the black moon in French and Italian and German and Dutch, but not much in English. But the Black Madonna, as its own, you know, essence, is the dark-faced feminine, the dark mother, the dark goddess, the dark, you know, face of the feminine that holds the knowledge of the mysteries and the Pisces Sophia. You know, it's definitely that wisdom goddess of the mysteries that are the untold, the hidden, the Gnostic, the esoteric. And she calls for devotion from many types of disenfranchised people, from the Rom people to the indigenous peoples who amalgamated their own goddesses to the Christian ones that came to rule over. The Virgin of Guadalupe is a version of this. So the Black Madonna truly is the miracle worker also in for those who accept her. And it's very personal, has a very personal relationship with her devotees.
Yeah, and I also thought it was fascinating is the story behind the asteroid 1181, how it was named. It was named after someone called Lilith, and a very interesting story, right?
The astronomer who discovers the asteroid gets to name it. So asteroid Lilith was the 1181. That was the order in which it was discovered, and it was a French astronomer working in Algiers who discovered it. So he named it Lilith in honor of a French prodigy musician named Lily Boulanger, who was born in the late 1800s and took Lily as a nickname from Lilith. Her true name was Juliette Marie Boulanger, and she was the first woman to win the Prix de Rome, a prestigious composing award, at the age of 19, and was just excellently talented on several instruments, but was mainly composing music and was very prolific for her short life. She died at the age of 24, and her older sister had been helping her and supporting her work. And her sister Nadia became the premier music teacher of the 20th century, teaching such students as Aaron Copland and others who have made such a mark in the world. And she also was the first woman to conduct several international orchestras. So Lili Boulanger left a legacy in many ways, but her music, the most evocative one, is called The Sirens. And it's such a Lilith piece. But she wrote music for many psalms and many poems, and as was the style in those days, and just very beautiful, beautiful music.
What are your views in Gnosticism, or as a modern Gnostic, you know, one of the goals is to restore Sophia back to the Godhead. And in Judaism, even exoteric Judaism, there's a belief in restoring the Shekinah back to God.
Yeah.
Lilith seems to represent this, restoring Lilith back to the garden, Lilith back to her own consciousness. Do you have a positive outlook of humanity's future, or are you, like many Gnostics, a little bit cynical about what's going on?
Oh, sort of a little bit of both, I think. But I hesitate to say I believe, but I do. I think I believe, ultimately, in evolution, but I think it really is to the individual. You know, humanity as a whole, like mass consciousness, can you know, be very hard to control. But you know, we're each individually responsible for our own state of consciousness, and I think that's where, you know, the hope lies, or the positive. I think that, you know, that there is a way to enlightenment, and that Lilith, who connects the serpent, the chthonic earth wisdom, up to the winged spiritual top of the tree and back down again, is a special level of consciousness, so that we do fulfill our incarnational desire. You know, the Buddhists say it's attachment to desire that's the problem, not desires themselves. And we have to follow our desires to fulfill our life and our karmas. And then our soul can be free. Then, you know, we are freed of that burden. But also, it's what is the one truest desire? For me, that truest desire is just the soul's liberation and return to the light. And that can happen in the body or beyond the body. But to me, that is, you know, that's the positive potential, that we can do that. It surely takes a lot of deep searching and is never going to be found outside ourselves, only deep within. And that's where Lilith wants to take us.
Well, I think that's all the time we have today, Kelley. I'd like to thank you very much for coming on Aeon Byte and discussing Lilith and some other very sapient topics.
It's been a delight. The hour's gone so quickly, and I'm so glad you found me, and I'm very glad to know about your website, too.
No, thank you very much. I'm glad I found you. It's very stimulating work, and good luck with your research and your continuing discovery of Lilith.
Thank you.
It is complete now. Two ends of time are neatly tied. A one-way street. She's walking to the end of the line. And there she meets the faces she's seen in her heart and mind. They say, goodbye. Tomorrow, Lilith, you're going to die. They say, goodbye. Tomorrow, Sophia, you're going to die. Not unless we have a say in the matter, now that I've corrupted a great song by Concrete Blonde. But there you have it, my beloved True Seekers. Kelley Hunter on the myth of Lilith and mucho más. She is a wonderful lady and scholar. One of my personal complaints has always been why there is such a minority of female truth seekers that come to Aeon Byte to express their esoteric discoveries. And believe me, I look hard for them. I guess we still have so much work to do. Again, Kelley is the author of Living Lilith, four dimensions of the cosmic feminine. For more information on Kelley, please visit her website, heliastar.com, heliastar.com. In our post-show emails, we've both been finding Lilith in new places. I'm sure you will too if you open your third eye and keep reminding yourself that you are not only living your own myth, you are part of the eternal stream of myth. And please, as I've warned before, don't get too tied to genders or gender roles when it comes to the spiritual argot called mythology. It's all about balance, wholeness, and a suitable framework to calibrate your gnosis. Dreams, symbols, and archetypes play their shifting Mata Hari dance in order to confuse our ego and the cosmic ego, the universal will Schopenhauer wrote about. A perfect example is how in the Kabbalah it operates on wisdom or chakma and makes her into a dude. The androgynous ideal, the egalitarian state of being, really has nothing to do with a dinghy or a jvebe. Like the Gospel of Tommy tells us, when you make the two into one, and when you make the inner like the outer, and the outer like the inner, and the upper like the lower, and when you make male and female into a single one, so that the male will not be male nor the female be female, when you make eyes in the place of an eye, a hand in the place of a hand, a foot in the place of a foot, an image in the place of an image, then you will enter the kingdom. Lilith and Sophia are coming back with the vengeance of a celestial Thelma and Louise. They, like our divine sparks, have been abused, raped, and slandered for millions of years. Enough is enough. We must fight the good fight and finish the race, my beloved true seekers, or we have failed in our commission of being the hero with a thousand faces and the champion eternal. And don't forget about Hypatia of Alexandria. So many blasphemous princesses to rescue from the black iron prison. But we will succeed because we are the Gnostics. We are the veterans of a thousand psychic wars who have set the controls to the heart of the sun. We run with those who are searching for the truth and avoid those who have found it. For we realize that man cannot know the truth but only embody it. Divided we stand, together we rise. There is no strength in numbers. Have no such misconception. Come on, dear boy, have a cigar. You're gonna go far. Jehovah keeps telling us outside the walls of the virtual Alexandria. But we tell him the dark moon is coming back. So the old man might think of lighting his phallic symbol soon, because the rains of the Pleroma are about to soak him to his heavenly bones. I am, and I am Abraxas, broadcasting at the virtual Alexandria through the godabovegod.com. The road is ended, this song is over, thought I'd have something more to say. But don't cultivate any troubles, my beloved true seekers, because like heaven above you, the spy that love you, I'm keeping all of your secrets safe with me tonight. Hello and goodbye as always. I'm a bitch.